Hello and welcome to another tutorial in monitoring of forest resources. My name is Lutz Fehrmann, and in this video I'm going to explain how we assess sample plots. Everything you learned up to now was about measurements on single trees, diameters, tree heights, other variables. But usually we are not selecting single individual trees from a list of all the trees in our forest, since we don't have such a list. We are rather assessing sample plots, and such a sample plot is a subset of the total forest area. If you consider the typical target variables of a forest inventory, like for example volume per area, or biomass per area, or number of trees per area, whenever you say per area, then it is clear that we are talking about a property of the forest area, rather than about properties of single trees. The most basic plot design is a fixed area sample plot, which might be a circle, for example, which would mean that we include and measure all the trees around the sampling location up to a certain distance. However, if you look in the background in this forest type, we find a lot of small trees, which only make a very tiny contribution to the total volume and biomass, and we only find a few of big trees, which is quite clear because bigger trees need more space and we find them in lower density. And that's why the typical plot design in such uneven-aged forest would be a nested plot design. Essentially, it means we are not using the same plot area for all of the trees, but we use different sizes of sample plots for different diameter classes of trees. And I will now show you how to do that. To plan an optimal size of nested plots, we would require some information about the density of trees in different diameter classes. At the moment, at this location, I'm going to implement a quite simple design for demonstration purposes. And it works as follows. I like to include all the trees which are bigger than 30 centimeters in DBH up to a distance of 13 meters. This would be the biggest circle. The smaller trees which are smaller than 30 centimeters are measured up to a distance of 6 meters. And the very small trees of 15 centimeters or less are only included in our sample and measured up to a distance of 3 meters. For the assessment of this plot, I'm going to use the vertex instrument and the transponder. And as I showed you already in an earlier video, we can use this as a sound tape. So I have calibrated the vertex because temperatures are quite low today. And I have switched on the transponder and now I can measure the distance to this sampling location from any point around it. And now let's start to assess this plot. Even if we have three different radii for different diameter classes, we would not assess them independently, but in one sweep. So in one 360-degree sweep around us, we would check every single tree, whether it's part of our sample or not. And I will start with this small tree just behind me. So this is my start direction. I wrote a number here. Not a permanent number, just with chalk, because I like to measure tree heights later. I don't like to do it now because it somehow interrupts my workflow, and that's why I give a number to all of these trees, also in case that I have questions or that I need to do some remeasurements. Let's check the distance for this tree. I like to measure a horizontal distance, which is not difficult in this terrain. So the distance of this tree is 2.8 meters. It is in the smallest circle that we have defined. And even if it's a quite small tree, this tree would become part of our sample. I would now assess all the variables that I have defined in my inventory protocol. And probably the DBH is one of them. So let's take a DBH measurement for this tree here. Remember, the measurement height of 1.3 meters, and this one has 14.3. So this is a typical variable that I would now report to a second person who is taking the notes and who is writing down or inputting everything into a field computer. I would now go on in a clockwise manner, so according to the direction angle, I would select the next tree to be checked in a clockwise direction. You see a bigger beech tree behind me, which is definitely more than 30 centimeters in dBH. So this tree could have a maximum distance of 30 meters. If it's closer, I would include it in my sample. I will now go there and check the distance. I hold the vertex a little bit down because I like to measure a horizontal distance, and this would be 10.7 meters for this beech tree here. So this tree would also be part of our sample, and I could take a measurement of dBH and later also tree height. Definitely it gets a number to be able to re-identify this tree later. You have also seen that I ignored a number of trees standing in front of me, these small beech trees, because they are definitely not part of our sample. They are too far away for the diameter class they have. I will check one more tree just to make it clear to you, and then you can imagine how we go on with the assessment of the sample plot. So we have another beech tree here. Let's check the distance. This would be 4.4 meters. So this tree has a distance of more than 3 meters. That also means this tree would only be included if the diameter is more than 15 centimeters. Let's check it. So this is 14.5. So you see, this tree, even if quite close to our sampling location, would not be part of our sample. In comparison to this one, which is even smaller, but very close to our plot, this will be a tree that is included in the smallest plot. Smaller than 15 centimeters, but a distance of less than 2 meters. So this is how I would go on, 360 degrees to assess all the trees in our sample plot or plots. And you can imagine that the different plot sizes will also have an effect on the expansion factor. It means that I need to take or need to consider different expansion factors for different trees depending on their dBH class. What I've measured now is the bearing or the azimuth to the tree that I have measured before, tree number one. Because in case that this is a permanent sampling location that we are going to revisit in 5 years or 10 years, and we are interested in estimating changes or the increment of diameters, for example, it would be necessary to identify each single tree. And we are usually doing this by determining the coordinates or the position of the trees by measuring the direction angle with a compass and, as we have already done, measuring the distance to the tree. And with the angle and the distance, we can compute the relative coordinates of each single tree in our plot. This can also be mapped and can be taken to the field next time when we come back in 10 years to re-identify all the single trees, and only then we can attribute the changes to the single trees. So now you have learned how to assess a sample plot, but up to now we have not talked about how to record the data that we have measured. It might be that you are using paper field forms, and if they are well designed, this is perfectly okay and very flexible. But nowadays we also have other technologies that we can use directly in the field, like for example an app for mobile devices where we can enter our data while we are still on the plot. Usually this helps a lot because we can also validate data in real time which might dramatically increase the data quality at the end. I know that you are very interested in that, and I will explain how it works and how you can design your own data app for forest inventories in one of our next tutorials. Thank you for watching so far, and see you in one of our next videos.